Number 347.
Probably many have, and I didn't call you pastors because I'm trying to be facetious, but I'm trying to bring out a point. I'm trying to remind us of how oftentimes we get a little mixed up about ministers in the pastorate and ordination. And I want to suggest there's a way in which each of us is ordained. How many of us, when we think of somebody ordained, we tend to think of somebody special, kind of above us? Isn't that what we often think? We often think that they're a little more spiritual, don't we? That they're in leadership at the church and other places. And we kind of give them fancy titles, don't we? We call them reverend, pastor, deacon, father, priest. But this morning, I want to define ordination a little more broadly, what I think is a little bit more scriptural than biblical. I want us to think of ordination in a little different light. And I want to begin with the passage that we just read. If you would, turn in your Bibles to Luke's Gospel. And I want to suggest that this is Jesus' ordination. And remember, in all things, Jesus is our pattern. He's our model. And so here Jesus is. He's beginning his ministry. He comes to John the Baptist, who's preaching a message of repentance. And Jesus is baptized, and when he comes out of the water, he hears those blessed words, "Well done, my good and faithful servant. In you I am well pleased." Isn't there a way in which God says those words to each of us? That point in our life where we say, "God, I'm all yours," doesn't he turn to you and to me and say, in effect, "Blessed are you, my son. Blessed are you, my daughter. In you, I am well pleased." I think there's a way in which that occurs in each of our lives. And if this is Jesus' ordination, there's a way in which you and I share in that ordination. In fact, that's all that ordination basically means. To be ordained means to be consecrated, invested, decreed, appointed, or established with ministerial authority and duty. Let's go a step further. Was there any pomp and circumstance to Jesus' ordination? Any choir singing? Did the bishop have to lay his hands on Jesus in order for him to receive ministerial authority and blessing? Did that have to occur? Not at all. Ordination is a spirit thing, isn't it? Those other things are just outward trappings, but the real meaning, the real significance, is what the Spirit does, isn't it? And have you noticed some churches or pastors that have all the pomp and circumstance, but is dead, lacking in spirit? You can have a form of godliness, but it lacks in power, right? We can have a form of religiosity. It almost is religiosity. That lacks the real spirit. And I just want to suggest when you and I, whatever place that is in our lives, when we reach that point where we said, in effect, "God, I'm yours." Sometimes with that we say, "God, I've messed up my life and I need you." But we all reach that point as believers where we say, in effect, "God, I'm yours. Holy Spirit, do with me as you would want to do. I'll go where you lead me. I'll do what you want me to do. I'm yours, Lord." I want to say to you and me at that point, you are ordained and I am ordained. We're set aside for the ministry that God gives to each of us. And that's what occurred to Jesus. And I believe it occurs to you and me. And I trust that you somewhere along in your lifetime said those words. I trust that you continue to say those words because we have to say them over and over again, don't we? It's like we're in a relationship with God. And it's like our other relationships. Do you tell your spouse you love her one time? You're committed to her one time? No, you should say that over and over again. I'm reminded of the gentleman at one of my former churches. I said to his wife, I said, has your husband told you he loves you? She said, yeah, my husband told me he loved me one time. And he said, if it changes, I'll let you know. That's not how it works in a relationship, is it? And that's not the way it works for you and me in our relationship with God. We say over and over again, God, I'm yours. And I hope you say it this morning again. And that is just simply an affirmation of your ordination. At that point, you are set aside for a ministry. You are a pastor. You're ordained. So I want you to turn to the person next to you and say, Pastor, you've never looked better. Look at the person next to you and say, Pastor, you've never looked better. Look at the person behind you and say, Reverend, it's good to see you. How do you feel to do that? A lot, right? But there's a way in which it's true. In fact, as Protestants, it's at the heart of our faith, isn't it? We have a doctrine called the priesthood of all believers. That means we don't need somebody to intercede with us, with God, through Jesus Christ. You and I can go to God, but it also means that God gives each of us a ministry. It may not be in the church, and thank God not all ministry occurs within the church. And thank God not all ministry is about ministers, because we'd be in a terrible pickle. But God sets each of us aside, ordains us for ministry in the world, wherever we find ourselves. Wesley, the founder of this Methodist mass, put it something like this. He said, the world is my parish. The world's your parish, and it's my parish. And we all are colleagues in ministry. We all are ordained in one sense or another. And so in a few moments, I'm going to send us forth. I'm going to ask you to affirm your ordination as you go out into the world, because we need more of us to affirm that ordination. One thing I learned this last week at the youth rally is we're living in strange times. The things our young people are experiencing and seeing, I just never even thought of. There's a darkness in the world around us. But he who's come into the world is light, and he is greater than the darkness. So we need more of us, each of us, all of us together, the whole priesthood of believers, to rise up and go forth into the world with the light. It's so important for us to do that. So I'm going to invite us to do that in a moment or two, but I want us to think just a few more moments about what that ordination of yours and mine looks like. The first thing I want to remind you and me is that it's an ordination of power. What does John say? There's one who's coming after me whose sandals I'm unfit to tie. He's going to come in power. What are the exact words? John says about our ordination, he says, I'm not worthy to untie the thongs of his sandals. He will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and with fire. His winnowing fork is in his hand to clear the threshing floor and to gather wheat into the granary, and the chaff will be burned with unquenchable fire. You and I have a power. We need to be aware of that. We need to affirm that, because so many of us Christians are walking around as if we're defeated. We just kind of want to get through life or get our ticket to heaven. But we're in a spiritual battle, and this world needs you and me to go forth and affirm the ordination that we are and live out the power that is ours. He tells us it's a power to change us, to shape us, to take that chaff. And we know the image there. In the ancient world, they would take grain and throw it up in the wind, right? And the chaff, which is lighter than the air, would be blown along, and the grain would fall to the ground. So we have the power within us to defeat those forces of wickedness. We have a power to overcome sin in our lives. If there's some area in your life where you know that you're not living as you ought to, affirm your ordination and know that you have a power within you who is greater than news in the world. are there battles you're facing in your workplace or in your family, know that there's a power within you through the Holy Spirit that's greater than he who is in the world. Our ordination is with a power. We're called to holiness. The chaff is blown away. We're refined. The grain remains. That's the work of the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is often called fire for that very reason. Back home, I think they have them here. How many of us are aware of forest fires or have seen forest fires on the hills surrounding Charlestown? I used to think they were so bad. But one thing I discovered growing up is those fires are often a source of renewal, aren't they? Often the deadest forests are those that are most mature, but those fires sweep through and they bring new life and growth out of those forests. In fact, there are some species that require fire in order to reproduce. And I think spiritually, you and I require fire to continue to grow. God's fire refines you and me. So your ordination and mine is one with power, but it's a special kind of power. It's there that I'd like to end by reminding us that the power given to us is a power that's revealed in weakness. What does the power of the world look like? How does the world define power? Wealth, right? It's the power of authority. It's the power of position. It's the power that lords over, isn't it? But Jesus calls us to a different sort of power. It's paradoxical if we compare it to the world around us. But it's a power that is revealed in weakness. Remember Jesus, when he was telling his disciples about their ordination, he gave them a living example. He was in the upper room. He took off his outer garment and he put a towel around himself. And he bent over with a basin of water and he washed their feet. He said, the rulers of the world around us, they've lorded over their followers, but I have given you a living example of the sort of authority that you and I are to have. Our power is found in service. It's found in weakness. We are baptized into Jesus' name. And it's a different sort of authority. It's a sort of authority that the world doesn't understand. It's the authority to serve under. In fact, John brings that out right before our passage. They come to John and they say, tell us about this ordination of ours. Tell us what it means to follow you. And John says, whoever has two coats must share with anyone who has none. And whoever has food must do likewise. He said to the tax collectors, don't cheat the people anymore. Only collect what you're supposed to. He says to those soldiers, don't extort money anymore. Our power is revealed in weakness. Isn't that what we see in the greatest saints in our midst or historically? St. Francis of Assisi, was he powerful? Yet it was all revealed in weakness. In the recent last century, who was one of the most powerful spiritual people you could think? Mother Teresa.
Mother Teresa.
Not even 100 pounds. Was she spiritually powerful? It was all in weakness. Claire Barton. Go on and on. Even Martin Luther King Jr., who we celebrate tomorrow, he had a power that was there through weakness. So I invite us this morning to affirm your ordination. You have been ordained. Christ, through the Holy Spirit, gives you a power, not as the world gives, but as only he can give, a power given to us in weakness. Will you accept your authority? When I was ordained, the bishop said these words to us. He said, take thou thy authority. I think that's God's word to all of us, clergy, because we're all colleagues. It's my word of admonition to each of us today. Take thou thy authority. You're ordained. Set aside for ministry. The world is your parish. Take your ordination and go forth and proclaim the gospel and live out the gospel in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Let us pray. Gracious and loving Lord, thank you for the Holy Spirit and for our ordination, Lord. We thank you that you call each of us beloved and set us aside for ministry. And Lord, we pray that you would give us a vision of the world as our parish. As each of us return to our homes, to our places of work, to school, to our daily lives, Lord, help us this day to reaffirm the authority that is ours through Jesus Christ, to be your hands and your feet, to proclaim your word, to live it out so that others can see our light. For that, dear Lord, we give you all the honor and the glory.